And we are back here at the Restaurant Masterminds podcast. And today, of course, it's going to be a fun one because we got rid of all the dudes, except for me, of course. But, of course, joining me is the infamous Miss Anna Townsend. How are you?
I'm great. I'm really great, Paul. A lady can dream one day the men will disappear, but that'll be okay. And then, but we've got another lady that's going to be joining us. There we go. Oh my God, I just like had a breath of fresh air. I'm really good.
She's not joking around.
I just. I have a wonderful day ahead of me. I'm headed down to check out our San Antonio restaurants later, and I have lunch with a influencer gentleman named Spurs Jesus. And I will let you guys
Spurs Jesus. I want that name.
He will be in his full regalia as we eat chicken fried steak and mashed potatoes later this afternoon. So I'll send you a photo, Paul.
So boots, cowboy hat, definitely my
kind. No hat. I don't think Jesus wore a hat.
No? Well, okay, no. But Spurs Jesus. I'm thinking definitely Spurs, I'm assuming.
Yeah, Spurs, like the basketball team, not the Spurs, like cowboy.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Okay, now I get it. All right. Well, listen, we are going to dive into the topic today of building the Gen Z team. And we're going to bring in a really cool guest expert on this topic. I think you guys are going to love it. Let's get to it. All right, so we are going to jump in. Before we get started with our guest today, I just want to remind everybody that we have a real purpose for this show. Sometimes people forget, and you know, sometimes it's not that we tout it that much, but we try to talk about it a little bit, and I think we should talk about it a little bit more, and that is our charities that we, basically this podcast was built around. Core Gives is one of our charities that we work with. And of course, you guys can visit coregives.org and learn a little bit more about them. But they are a charity along with another one that I'll talk about in a second that really focus on the restaurant and hospitality space. And the idea behind this podcast is we have a donation page over on saver.fm. When you hit the show page, you can donate there. And all of the proceeds go to supporting these two charities. The other charity that we, of course, have is the people over at Southern Smoke. And Southern Smoke does a great job as well. They're both very similar. And the idea behind them are very simple. And that is to support restaurant workers and operators in a time of need. Southern Smoke, of course, does quite a few things around emergency relief. And also, they have a mental health program, which is really cool. So if you guys are really interested in supporting the restaurant industry, all I ask you to do is visit saver.fm. And of course, that will get you to our show page over there. I'll show it before we end the podcast today so you can find out. And that's where you can donate. It's very simple. It's like PayPal or a credit card. Anything that you give quarterly, we wrap that all up and we send it over and split it up between those two charities. So
I'm glad we do that, Paul. I really appreciate doing that. That's awesome.
And you know, the problem is, I think with the industry is a lot of times podcasts are more vanity projects than anything, because many of them don't make money, as you know. But I think with this one, when we brought together the A-team, you know, that is the masterminds, that was one of the core missions of trying to build something that could really you know, hopefully make a little bit of a difference. Just a little dent, man. Just those little dents.
A little. it matters. It adds up. And I've been working with Southern Smoke and Core for a long time, and they're such good organizations. Really.
Yeah,
good.
We've had a chance to chat with them, and it's I just love the effort and, you know, the passion that's behind those programs. Anyway, let's get to our topic today, which is building a Gen Z team. And of course, joining us from Barcelona Wine Bar is Miss Amy Hom. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
So we are fantastic. Last time we got a chance to have you on one of our podcasts was over at the Prosper Forum. So that was an excellent one with Stacey Kane co-hosting that one. So
yeah,
ended up being a really good topic. Yeah, it was a good topic. And it was fun. So today I want to get into the area of building a Gen Z team. But before we completely jump into that, I want to learn a little bit more about what's happening over at Barcelona Wine Bar. You're kind of new there. How long have you been over there now?
About 6 months and trending up. So that's good. We are focused on our collection of restaurants. So we started a new restaurant concept called Corsica. Our first one's in Reno in Denver. And okay. We've got a second one coming on the map very soon. So just looking, learnings, all the things, as well as continuing to look for some great spots for Barcelona as we scale.
Yeah. If you guys have never looked at Barcelona Wine Bar and you need to really learn a little bit more about what they're doing, fantastic place. I've been to one here in Wynwood, down here in Florida. It's one of my favorite spots. And if you like wine and you like what I think is a really good hospitality experience, you got to go over to Barcelona Wine Bar and really kind of just jump in. There's the Florida locations. You guys have Tampa coming soon.
Yeah.
What's the deadline for that?
That was supposed to be this upcoming week, but we're going to rely on Helena to calm down there in the hurricane so that we can get it back on track. We're sandbagged and ready to go. So
yeah, as we're recording right now, of course, I'm over on the eastern coast, so it's a little bit sunny behind me, but man, the wind bands.
Oh, you can see it. Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
So Amy, let's get into it today. I want to talk about building, and Anna, I'm going to kind of ask you some questions too, because you running the restaurant group you have, I think are also kind of tuned into this idea of building a different kind of workforce. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that is going to be coming from Gen Z. Amy, let's start with you. First of all, with Barcelona, I know this, that you guys do a lot of culture-driven things that are really tied to
We have Be Love. It's our internal employee contribution, you know, where they can donate to help others out. So when the employees get into a pinch and apply. Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing.
I love that. Yeah. It's, you know, kind of helping the family out really, if you think about it.
100%.
So how is that? I guess, what's the response you get from a Gen Z when they first come on, you know, they're onboarding, they're learning, and they hear about those kind of culture things? Do they recognize this? Is it valuable to them? Tell me a little bit about how it works there.
I think it's as valuable as the company makes it, right? So when we're discussing, like, October is Be Love Month, we are going to be kicking it off and telling stories where, without names, but where they folks have been impacted, making sure that everybody knows how to sign up and what the differences it makes. It can be life-changing for some folks. And a lot of the team members that we have currently, they're going through things, whether their car breaks down, they lose their apartment, they go through some traumatic experience, and they can apply. And we've got a Be Love committee that puts all their efforts into making sure that the money goes to the right places.
Yeah. So you've got eligibility.
And how do people, like, is this all company funded, Amy, or is employees put into this, or how does it work?
It's all employee funded. And whether it's $1 or $50 a paycheck, we handle that for them. And then it goes into the fund. And then we distribute it based on priority and what the situations are.
Right. Cool. On Gen Z's, and this will, I kind of want to run this by you, Anna. I know you're in the midst of building kind of a new presence for a group down there that is and has been an icon within South Texas, the Austin to Braunfels area. Talk to me about how you guys go about reaching this next generation of employees, because this is, it's a little different mindset than what we've seen in the past with millennials.
It is. And just to back up a little bit to give people an understanding of what Gen Z is, those are people born, according to Google, between the years of 1997 and 2012, and they're known as digital natives or born digital, whereas millennials were sort of the migration. They migrated to digital. These people are between the ages of, it says 12 to 27. I feel like that's a little young. I feel like Gen Z is a little bit older than that at this point. So that might be a little off at this right now, but they are younger, right? They are younger. I think they're going to change the world. I'm really excited to see what Gen Z's do. my generation, the millennial generation, set it up and we need them to slam dunk it now.
There you go.
So whenever we talk about the Gen Z workforce, you know, at our operations, so we run 5 different restaurants, 3 in Green, just part of New Braunfels in mm-hmm. Texas, and then 2 in San Antonio. We're really, really lucky. We have a lot of universities around us. So that's really helpful in sort of creating this top of funnel bucket to drive employees over to us. And we do a lot of word of mouth recruiting. I mean, the people that work in our restaurants do well. They make really good tips. And so a lot of word of mouth recruiting is very helpful. We give bonuses for people that, recruit or refer someone in and they get recruited and then they stay a certain amount of time. They get a bonus for that, which is really great. We both do. And it's really helped, you know, create a better culture too. And what's interesting is a lot of people in the restaurants, they really enjoy sort of trading stories back and forth. Anytime I go over to visit the restaurants, like they're just multi-generation are able to laugh and get along together because we have a really strong culture of transparency and excellence. And that really helps them know where to fit in. I think Gen Z does well with structure and reminders of that they're doing well. Like you need to remind them about their performance frequently and point out their various scenarios where they performed well. Whereas I feel like other generations maybe didn't need that constant feedback. And Gen Z does. And there's nothing wrong with it because I think it's good of us as older managers to give that feedback as frequently as possible.
Well, so, that's interesting you said that because giving feedback to them, this was a report that was done here by Apollo Technical. I want to show this stat. 16% decrease in retention rates for employees who aren't comfortable giving upward feedback. So that's, you know, that's the employee giving the feedback back to the organization.
Oh, they tell us, trust me, they tell us, they have a lot of feedback. And you know what? Some of it is moments where you're like, okay, they may not fully understand a situation. So the feedback that they're given is not quite relevant, but they don't know that. And so you have to know how to receive that and help them understand a little bit more. But I think it's great. I love the gumption and the chutzpah of this generation of being able to point out things and try to fix it and move forward. They're not just complainers. They're coming up with solutions. And I really love that.
So Amy, when you look at building a team, are you starting to see Gen Z going to the management slots there at Barcelona?
It depends on the culture, but yes, we're starting to see an influx. We want to become the development company next year is kind of one of our visions is Barcelona Weinberg, a development company. If you come in, we'll help you get from dishwasher to where you want to go or server or manager. And there's a few things that are important that Anna said as well, which is they want that instant gratification feedback, celebratory. So one of the things we do is whether you use the Slack platform or use GChat, we have created channels since I've joined and gotten everyone on the channels. So we have a celebration chat, for example. Yeah. And there was no connection between the home office or the support center and the front lines, right? So now they post, the office will post, they'll post, they like the instant gratification, the emojis, but it's all about celebrating one another and saying, hey, we had a great event tonight, or hey, we broke sales, or hey, you know, so-and-so just had a baby. We have to lean and lead more with EQ more than ever in any industry, honestly, in the leadership role. So diving in and getting to the heart of all that and understanding that is how that generation and our generation, that they complement each other because we are all coming along, right? We all understand the technology and how important it is. So bringing some of those components in, we do heart checks regularly. If I call somebody today and I say, hey, Paul, how are you doing today? And you know, what's your heart check? And it's just become an automatic of 1 to 5. And if you're a 2, I'll hang up on a group call and call you back and say, tell me what's going on. Because it matters. And it might have been I said something to them, or they were in a meeting and something was said that they didn't agree with, or they're just having a bad day, right? And so that's really important. One of the things that I was speaking to Emily Williams Knight on is we're at a 10-year high at GM and AGM turnover of 68%, which I actually was pretty alarmed in that. So as we are focusing our efforts internally into Barcelona Wine Bar, it's the celebration chats, it's training differentiation. They're kinesthetic learners, operations usually are. And you have to ask that person when they start, how do you learn? right? And making sure that we have all the technology and all the hands-on experience that they may need to help them grow. And then we have development plans for every single manager and GM and executive chef and sous chef, like right. all the things where their supervisor will sit down every month and just say, tell me, what do you need to go work out more? Do you need to read a book more? Do you need to learn yeah. a podcast?
Like well, find their out. Yeah. Find their outlets.
What do you need to do that you're not hitting on? And let's set some 30-day goals. And then also they show up better in the workplace and they're a better employee for us for investing in that. So lots of things we got a lot of things going on, but it's all good stuff. And we're seeing a lot more, I would say the supervisor level now a higher interest into mm-hmm. going into the general manager and AGM and manager roles.
Well, and with labor, I think, you know, the challenge that we had here in the US and also in the restaurant industry around being able to retain labor. This was another stat that was in the same report talking about onboarding. And you kind of mentioned this a little bit, but this is, if you can do it right, it looks like you can really retain employees at least for, you know, 3 years based on this data. When you look at onboarding right now and you kind of consider some of the key things that are required within it, what do you think is the like one of the big hits of onboarding that you have to really do well?
Timing of their process. It has to be faster than it ever has been. You know, that we all used to say you got to hire slow and fire fast. And now yeah. it's hiring faster and it's reversed. And so, because great talent will just walk down the street and get a job yeah, that day because of technology supporting their assessments and how that, you know, you have AI responding to the candidates. So it's a different workplace when it comes to the onboarding. Now, we all remember our first day and our last day of any job. It's the first impression. So they're either going to think in their head and they decide, I believe there's some science behind it. They decide on that day if they're going to stay for the first 90 days, if they're already thinking this isn't
working. Literally, you have one day to do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And they, the generation's just different. And so they now, where our generation was changing careers or jobs three times, they're shown now to do 10 plus. They'll just go do something else.
Yeah.
It's so how do we keep them?
Because I know with me, I'm the elder here, Gen X, and I look at it and I think when I would go, you know, meet somebody for the first time, whether it's a partnership or a job or anything, I would never want to make a decision without at least 2 or 3 weeks of really seeing that person in action. So I can, you know, kind of pull all the nuances from it. And I always thought that was fast, but one day, wow. Okay.
Subconsciously, you're thinking, I got to figure that I'm out. Like, I'm not, this place is a mess. I'm going.
I'm out of here.
Yeah. No. They'll figure it out really fast. They even like, you know, we've had situations where people will go to the interview, they get the offer, and then they just don't show up.
Like, there's no connection.
Something must have happened during that process where they didn't feel the
you
connection.
Just don't have the riz.
They just don't want to be part of it. Yeah.
You don't have the riz, as they say. Yeah.
They look, they, it's okay. Different rather than they have to work now. They're in a place. Are we doing cats now? We
went from no, he cats? Was trying to sound like a Gen Alpha.
Like the Gen Zs. Because we have one that works with our team, and I get a glossary from him because I never really understand what he's saying. So he just says, all right, let me give you the glossary. So he gave me like 20 terms that they use and what they mean. And I was like, oh, well, I completely understand what you're saying.
Us ladies are not sure that's good for you, Paul.
I don't think you need to be doing that, honestly.
Hey, now at least I understand what he's talking to me about.
Fair. Fair.
You're understanding the next generation. That's good.
Yeah, it's good. But you have to understand how the English language is different. Literally different.
Yep.
So that's kind of fun. You hit on a couple of points there, and I thought this is interesting. And you talked a little bit about AI in, you know, both response, but now, of course, I mean, AI is still readily available. Most Gen Z I know, including our own team, they're utilizing AI on a daily basis. They're in much a little different kind of workforce, but still, do you feel like that is, how do you take that? You know, if someone that comes to you, they've given you an AI resume and dossier, they've given you AI responses and they've prepared AI responses to the questions that you might ask in the interview, because these are, you know, well and well-documented scenarios. Have you seen any of that yet?
Oh, of course we have. I think both of us have. It's really having a human conversation with them and forgetting about the resume, the answers, and just getting to know them as a human. And would they be a good fit for us from a integrity standpoint? Do they bring positivity? Where's their thought process? Are they an opposed, proposed thought leader? All the things. And so you can't get that off of paper. And it's interesting, I will say this too, is that some people interview as a complete badass and then you hire them and you're have an oh no moment because you're like, you talk the game really well.
Yeah,
you
think, yeah.
There's no such thing as 100% hiring track record. But there are times until you get them. Now, managers, we do stages with and we do side-by-sides in restaurants. What do you see? What do I see? Eye for detail, all the things. But for hourly, they need to come in, you know, we need to see them in person. And now they're, you know, I would have never, when I was growing up in the industry, walked in with a pair of shorts on, but it's acceptable now. And we have to think about those things. We have to change the way that we feel about it.
Anna, when you're working with the team you have, I'm sure you have a group of Gen Z, and you look at you know, like most management teams, you kind of look at your A players, your B players, your C player kind of thing. When you start to identify an A player and you want to keep them and you're in a position where you're trying to maybe give them more responsibility, wherever it might be that kind of advocates for them, what does the rest of the team look like, especially if they've been hired maybe at the same time? Have you seen any kind of interaction that has, you know, from an observation standpoint?
That's a little tricky because I'm not in the ops all the time. You know, I run the marketing team, so it's a little bit different. We do have, I'm blessed to have a Gen Z, and about to hire another one, to the team, that helped me with marketing. And honestly, I don't know if we do that. I mean, we all have very different roles to play. Mm-hmm. And I think setting those guardrails around you do this, and this is the expectation, and this other person next to you does a different thing and they have this expectation. And that seems, we do that in public too. It's not like a hidden thing.
Yeah.
All the metrics are out there for everyone to see. And we meet every week to talk about if we're hitting those metrics. So that it doesn't really feel like one person is rising above another.
I see. So Amy, do you guys, I mean, turnover is a big deal here in the restaurant industry. With Gen Z, from the data that seems to be coming in, it's even a little bit higher than what we've seen in the past, just because of the flexibility and the opportunities that are out there. That technology has really opened up, I think, more so than anything. Now you can apply, you know, through AI to, you know, 100 jobs where it used to take you, you know, 3 days to do that. Mm-hmm. It takes you, you know, 30 minutes. When you see that turnover comparison, how do you guys address that in being able to handle it?
Well, most companies, along with ourselves, do the team member surveys, team member voice. The other thing is we stay very close to doing roundtables. Our GMs are being currently trained now to complete their own in their own restaurants. But I've been doing roundtables with the GMs. In your article, it talked about I think it was 19 or 18% of the folks that didn't feel great about reporting up and giving great feedback. And the only thing I ask the team is, you know, propose your solution. But let's talk about it and let's fix. Now, the biggest thing I think that can really help that I see happen is a lot of leaders will go ahead and they'll take the feedback. So you're listening to that person that might be leaving or thinking about it. You're doing these roundtables, you're infusing yourself into the business. But if you don't follow up and you don't have a conversation about the things that were said in that roundtable in like 72 hours or early the following week, they no longer will voice their opinion. You will lose them.
Yeah.
And so I have a partner that sits in on those calls and helps me go after it the minute we hang up. Is call this department. Let's find a strategy for this. And some of it is, hey, we can't do anything about that. I hear you. And we're going to note it. But we need to make sure that we're putting that in the notes and following up. And then the GMs have to do daily check-ins with their team. And we have to do daily check-ins at the support center.
Right.
So again, it's a people business. I think everybody mostly knows that. So
I'm so glad you bring that up, Amy, the idea of like the roundtable and like following up. We have daily check-ins with our team's leadership team. And then I know the ops have their daily check-in as well. And we have a weekly tactical meeting as well for each of those different groups. And, you know, there's things, there's action items that come right from that that need to be followed up on immediately. And if you don't bring it up, you know, it does, you lose some credibility quick with your younger team, you know,
for
if
sure.
you are not staying on top of it.
And, yeah.
You know, whereas I feel like people used to get a pass a little bit, but now, no.
Yeah. I walked into a restaurant the other night and I said, what's going to make your job easier? It was the bartending team. And I said, we just need these 10 buttons added. We have to do 10 pages through and it's a very simple thing. And then I called the beverage team and emailed them the list. And I said, can we make this happen? And they did it the next day. And I said, then you email the bartenders or tag them or whatever on a channel and you say, hey, this got fixed. And they're like, their voice is heard. The follow-up's happening. And when you go in again, their walls are down and they have all the answers. I don't have the answers. Our CEO doesn't, like, it really is them. They're doing it day to day. And you go back to the dishwasher and you wash dishes for a minute to make sure their equipment's working. Like you got to fly low to fly high for sure. In decisions.
Yeah. Well, the data, I just showed this on screen a little minute ago. This was the 2019 data, but the 2022 data had increased. But the 2019 data was the worst retention industries out there. The number one, by only half a point, was arts and entertainment and rec. So that's mostly, I would say, maybe acting and music, et cetera. But leisure and hospitality was number two at 79% in terms of retention rate. Mm-hmm. In 2022, that jumped up to 81.2. So it was going up over just the past 3 years. Obviously, that has been because of, you know, we all know with the pandemic, it's kind of repositioned the work from home, even the how businesses are operating. When you look at that right now for both of you, how much of a change has that made for even the administrative side of your teams? You know, because it's a lot less office work, I'm assuming, or is it all in the restaurant itself? Where are you seeing, you know, areas like that being addressed?
It's the culture you provide. It's the atmosphere. It's the climate. It's checking in on them. And then it's also strategizing. It's all the things and making it a place where you're not in a place of you need an employee. They get to work there. And so it's constantly a mindset and listening to them and saying, you know, what do you need? Most of our restaurants have zero needs in hourly positions. We're a night business, the bartending, the staff, right? So we're not, but I've been in other concepts as of recent that you're really struggling to find those hourlies. And it all comes down to the culture that you're bringing in the business. And it's you have to lead so much more with EQ. Yes, the data matters. Yes, you have to have a business strategy, all of that, but it plays into the strategy now where I don't think it was as important as it was a couple of years ago. And mind you, yes, the pandemic, all the things happened, but so did Uber. So did all these tech jobs. Entrepreneurship is an all-time high in that generation. So we have to, that's why we have, you know, we're doing lead tonight. It's like, how do you keep this generation engaged and let them know what a sexy kind of, like we have a really cool, sexy business we're all in and it's a party every day. And how do you make sure they feel that when they come to work, it's a party every day and they're heard and they get to make changes and they have decision rights and they're making a difference, whether it's in the community they're in or with Be Love, all the things, you have to make sure you're tying all the pieces together.
So Amy, you look at the generation gaps that are out there right now, I would say Gen X and even millennial to a certain extent, working with Gen Z and possibly even for the younger audiences that are coming, I should say employees that are coming in with the Alpha Gen. Do you find that there is a generation gap at all? Or do you feel like these are tighter generations than what we've seen in the past with the boomers?
I think when you step back, I do think there is a difference. I think the way that the different generations learn, the way you put a training platform together, the way you interview, it's all, you really have to read the room. When they're in a group setting, you're talking to them at a high level over general. But at the end of the day, if that leader's not really dialed into that specific person on what's going on in their life, how's soccer going, how are the kids, all the things, and really checking in with them as a human versus not just business, like some of us grew up with and we were fine with, that's where you see a little bit of the difference in the generations and how you're leading them.
Yeah, I think that's it's going to be
one. Expectations. When you have different generations in the restaurants, you have one that'll come in and just execute, right? Our generation, they'll come in, they just want to come in, they want to do their job, they check out, they're good. They still want to feel good about work. The other ones have to feel like there's a purpose. They have to be, the purpose and the why has to be a constant conversation. What do we do at Barcelona? How do we help the community? But also, this is why we do it. And my generation, we didn't really care about the why. This is a why and purpose-driven generation. And so, go ahead.
To your point, like they could just go down to another organization that does have the why figured out, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that is so great important. Point. We did a study when I was with Big Chicken. We did a study with University of Southern California with their applied psychology program and asked them to go take a look at what Gen Z workforce needs. And one of the big things they pointed out was like a why, and they don't want their brands that they work for to sit on the sidelines around difficult conversations. Mm-hmm. And that has been very tricky to navigate because as a restaurant, restaurants are apolitical. We are not in that game. Like, thank goodness. There are some hot button issues that a lot of our Gen Z workers have come to us and said, we want you to take a position on this. And we can't, you know, because we don't want to alienate our customers or our other workforce. Like it's really tricky. And so you have to find other ways to demonstrate the why of your restaurant or your brand. You know, what do you give back to the community? What do we mean to this community? How are you participating in that? And that's really helpful. And then another thing too that Amy mentioned around, you know, having a party every day. One of our restaurants is, I call it the Grand Dame. It's called the Gristmill River Restaurant in New Braunfels. And there's no air conditioning. It is multi-layers, levels of stairs that you're running up and down. Those people get a workout every day. I mean, it is brutal, but they are in the trenches together, and that camaraderie around taking care of these guests together, it brings them together. So I almost think like a more physical job, like working at the Gristmill, makes them even tighter. I don't know what the psychology is there.
Bonding. I think a lot of times you start to bond in certain high risk or high intensity situations like that. This was an interesting chart I wanted to show you, ladies. And it shows the five generations coexisting in the workplace. And I wanted to take the difference between Gen X and Gen Z. So Gen X, work ethic, work style, flexible arrangements, you know, having a little bit of autonomy, motivators, recognition, and career advancement. You get on the motivators over on Gen Z, and it's purposeful work and financial incentives. And the work style is still flexible. Structures that promote a work-life balance. So not completely different. I think both those generations would work well together because they kind of see it as the same opportunity. What I thought was interesting was on the millennials, on the motivators, career growth and personal development. So they're trying to build more about them as opposed to the purpose of what their work is. So
well, when that was a call.
I was just going to say, that is now proven to be the number one leading factor as to why they leave. If they don't feel like they're being developed, and that's why we really focus on development plans. But it's that generation of making sure they know where they're going to go and having investment conversations into their careers.
Boomers went back to recognition, accomplishments, traditional perks. And then the traditionalists, these are the 1925 to 45. I don't know that there's many of them out there in the workforce in this space, but there might be. Motivators were titles, prestige, and retirement. So that was the only area where retirement was mentioned in the entire motivator analysis of all five generations. And I thought,
that's because people don't think retirement's going to happen. Doesn't exist. But I think your chart is really interesting too. If you think about where the motivations come from and who they were raised by. Right. So millennials were raised by boomers overall, generally, and Gen Z were often raised by Gen X. And so it's kind of interesting to see that connection too. You know, you've got young kids, Paul. I don't think yours are.
Ours are alphas though, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So same minor alphas too. So we'll see. We'll see what millennials and Gen X raising those kids is going to be like. But I do think it's really interesting that, you know, Gen X experienced, you know, motivation through recognition and career advancement. And they taught that to their kids, the Gen Z, through finding purposeful work and something that means something. I think it's great.
So to be a great workplace, you have to tie all this together.
Yeah. Right?
So that they don't feel like you're doing it for a certain generation, but you're that's commingling, and you got to do almost all of that and make that important at time, you know, and just, it's, I had listened to or just read a book about this, but you have to be the chief repeating officer at all times. So it's, we have bee loves and you got to carry a tray, right? So
yeah. I read the same book, Amy.
Yes.
Well, was it Lencioni?
Yes.
Yes.
And it's he's my, one of my faves. Five Dysfunctions of a Team is my fave. But as you read that, to be a great company these days, you have to keep up with all of that, and you've got to do all of it, and you have to talk about it. There has to be a conversation.
Yeah.
And so that's where all the components play. Do I think leadership at the regional director level, VP level, I think it's a little heavy in our you know, restaurants right now. But I think once we come out of it and they become these chief repeating officers, everything's just going to kind of stick, because the turnover becomes high.
Yeah.
You constantly got to bring all of this in, because there are always new people in the business. So
yeah, for sure.
Got to do it all. You got to do it all to be fabulous.
I like that. You got to do it all to be fabulous. That should probably be that sounds like a good title for this podcast. Do it all to be fabulous. This is a good one. Make sure, guys, if you're watching on the video version of this, maybe you're catching this on YouTube, just hit like and subscribe right now. And if you are on the podcast apps out there, whether it's Spotify or iTunes or maybe one of your web or version 3 podcast apps, if you're on some of those, make sure and just give us a few stars. That does help us. And of course, as I remember, as always say, also check us out over on saver.fm, and you can find everything over there. Last words for Amy Hom on Gen Z and adapting to this workforce. What do you give us as the takeaway tip here? Because you're in the trenches, Amy. You're in there with the crew we're talking about right now. Mm-hmm. What would you say is your takeaway from a management standpoint?
One word. Well, no, I'll give two. Listen and follow up. I guess that's three.
Listen. Well, I like listen and follow up. That's good.
Listen and be the chief repeating officer.
Yeah. I like it. I got to read that book. What's the name of the book again?
It's called The 5 Dysfunctions of a Team by Patrick Lencioni. Okay. It's really good. Most of his books are really short. They're great.
5 Dysfunctions of a Team. Perfect. Well,
although I think the chief repeating officer, I have to look it up. I'm trying to remember if that was him. It was the gentleman, Paul, that just spoke at Amelia Island.
Oh, one of the keynotes?
Yeah.
Prosper?
Yeah. Yeah. I'll have to message it to you.
Okay. I'll have to look at that.
Yeah.
Check it out for sure. Amy can be reached over at Barcelona Wine Bar. Of course, you can hit her up on LinkedIn if you guys have any questions or follow up with her. She's really good about sharing information in the industry. That's one of the things I love about you, Amy. So thank you so much for your work.
Thanks for having me. It's awesome seeing you both. Good morning.
Good to see you. I know. Have a great wonderful morning.
Thank you.
Yeah. Get out there and let's do something fun today, right?
Yes. Bring the party.
All right. We'll see you later, Amy. Thanks
a lot. Thank you.
Okay. So of course, this wraps up another podcast. I think when we see the amount, and we're having a lot more interviews on the podcast now for masterminds. So we'll be sprinkling those three together. We've got some restaurant founders coming in. We've got some operators like Amy coming in that are working in a lot of these multi-unit brands. And then we've got some founders that are doing startups that are not necessarily in the restaurant space, but I think in our team, we're looking at what they were bringing to the table, Anna. So I think this is going to really give us another, you know, leg of the stool here for Mastermind.
That sounds wonderful. Yeah, that sounds great. Fun. I love it.
A lot more interviews, a lot more insights from those. Anna, anything new over at your restaurant group that you can share?
We're in deep in holiday planning and planning for 2025. So we've got some really cool stuff coming up. We're working on some big media projects, which is going to be really fun. So I'm just pumped. We're, you know, the little town that we operate most of our restaurants in, we're going big on Christmas lights this year. We want everyone to just get outside and be part of the community and have a festive time.
Very cool.
We're spending a little bit more to make sure that the town looks really nice and all the restaurants look really good too. So
Green
I would encourage everyone to do that. Mm-hmm. Green Texas, spelled the German way.
Let me ask you a quick question, because I was looking at that area and I remember I don't know if it was your operation or not, but that there was like a fishing process or something to do with I can't know if it was, I don't know if it was trout or something that was like in Green, Texas. Is that right? Am I hearing that right?
We eat a lot of catfish.
I'm going to find that because okay. it was research I was looking at because I'm trying to get Graham, my son, very yeah. young. And I want him to go on a real river fishing tour, not that, without going up northwest. So
okay.
Texas is pretty good. If you get,
we've got a lot. Yeah, we do have a lot of freshwater fishing. So that's true.
Yeah, so that was an area that I was looking at. And for some reason, Green, Texas came up.
You know, we talk about that occasionally. Most of the people that are in the water around us are in tubes, inner tubes. And so
yeah, that's true.
We're big on tubing culture down here.
Yeah, for sure. And it was good to see you. Thanks again for jumping in here on the Restaurant Mastermind Podcast.
Good luck with Helene, right? She's whirling around behind you, I think.
Yes. Yeah, she is. She's coming on. But we're on the outer rim, so it's just mostly the wind bands and the rain. Right now, the west coast of Florida is the one that is going to take a mostly northwest. I think it's going to be up
near. That's right, Apalachicola. All right, well, luck and prayers to our friends in Florida.
Crazy, yeah. All right, guys, thanks again for listening in here on the Restaurant Mastermind Podcast. As always, great to see you. Make it a great week. We'll catch you later.